Together, get it right. here. I don't have to go up front. Today is our summer, our kickoff for our summer mission project. This year, we have decided that our monies gathered through the summer will be going to the Pregnancy Help Center. In the back is a baby bottle for all of you to take home as a reminder. Now, usually the jar that you collect your change and things in, that you put money that comes to you as, I would say, a gift from God through the course of the summer, unexpected money, however you decide to fill your jar, I hope you use a bigger jar. And that is one of those that gets to count the money after this is over. I hope you count your money at home and put a check in your bottle. It makes it so much easier, but we will take your jar of cash if that's what you want to bring in. The rescue mission, we have a video we're going to show you, a short video. And has just been doing a wonderful work in this area, in this community. Again, the idea of this project is trusting God to fill your jars. This is not to sacrifice or to take your money from somewhere else. God, if you trust God to provide extra, however you decide to do it through the course of the summer, these jars get filled and we usually end up with a very nice amount of money. By October, we will count the money and give it to a representative from Pregnancy Help Center in October. There are also little flyers. I put one on the bulletin board back there. I'll put them around. They have a program where if you decide you want to donate throughout the year, you can do it through your computer or through the mail. So I'll leave these around so that if you feel led to do something throughout the year, you can do it. We are also going to be doing kind of a baby shower. We're going to have a basket available. And throughout the summer, if you see something, especially something that is disposable, you know, all of you mothers know that you just go through diapers and wipes and lotions. No baby powder, please, they said. Onesies, if you want, but make them larger than newborn. Clothing, shoes, they have a lot of newborn. And she said, it's amazing, the size of the babies being born today. They never get to wear the newborn stuff. So, anything that you pacifiers, anything that you find that you would like to bring in and donate, we will have a basket collecting those throughout the summer also, and we'll present them to Sally or whoever comes on the 17th of October. Every mother who goes through the program, which we'll really explain, gets a pillowcase full of newborn necessities, things to help her with her newborn. And that's where this stuff will go. You'll also see little clips from a store they have where these things go. And they will explain how the mothers earn the right to shop in that store. So I'm going to let Linda show you the video. It really explains why we chose them for our summer project. And I thank you. Don't forget your baby bottle, Linda.
Hello, I'm Sally Dubinsky, the Executive Director of Pregnancy Help Center. We're so glad that you've joined us to hear what God has done throughout this year and what He is currently doing. You will get to meet each of our staff members as they share their piece of the ministry. Our clients come to us with difficult stories, and our staff meets with them and shares God's truth with them. We sent out recommitment letters to many of you who gave at last year's banquet, asking if you would match that gift since we couldn't have our banquet this year. If you don't have a recommitment form, put pregnancyhelpcenter.com/pledge in the search bar on your computer, and it will take you directly to the pledge sheet, which can be filled out online. Or you can go directly to pregnancyhelpcenter.com, click the Get Involved link, and 2021 Pledge. What a blessing this is for the ministry and the clients we serve. Your gifts save lives, and we are grateful.
On behalf of our clients, I personally want to thank all of you for your generous donations and prayers, especially during this time of the pandemic. When the governor closed businesses, we managed to meet needs of our clients. And during that time, the six-week period time actually, we gave out 162 packs of diapers, 42 packs of wipes, and 268 packs of baby items.
I'm Jody, the Client Services Director. Thank you for your financial support. You have made it possible for us to do two new and exciting things in the Client Services Department. Our clients earn points watching parenting videos, and up until this year, this was done with DVDs. We are now using a new streaming service called Brightforce. Through Brightforce, our clients have the most relevant and up-to-date videos, giving them information to help them parent, while earning points to get items they need for their children. We are also excited to tell you about another digital resource we are using called Hoaxing. Hoaxing is a new way we can communicate to our abortion-minded clients using videos and literature sent directly to their phones, reaching them in a way that is familiar and relevant. But the most exciting part of Hoaxing includes you, our supporters, giving you the opportunity to pray in real time for our clients while they are in the center. When an advocate is meeting with a client, we are able to send a text asking for prayer for the client who is considering abortion, choosing life, hearing the gospel, or giving their life to Christ. To be part of this life-changing prayer opportunity, please visit www.lifeprayerpartner.com/PHC330 or call the center at 330-788-4000 and ask for Jody or Jessica to sign you up.
My name is Nicole Hopper, Nurse Manager at the Pregnancy Health Center, and my name is Betsy Tiger, Staff Nurse. We want to take a moment to say thank you. We never could have expected the events of 2020. But with your generous donations, we've been able to purchase the proper PPE and sanitation supplies that we needed to safely care for our clients. We are here, we are open, and running at full capacity. It is only possible because of you, your support, and most importantly, your prayers. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kathy, one of the advocates here at the center. Because of your faithfulness to our ministry, I'm able to come into this room with our girls and share the love of Christ as we discuss their options for their unplanned pregnancy. The option to carry a parent, to carry a place for adoption, or the true facts about abortion. And for a young woman who have chosen abortion in their past, I can introduce our abortion recovery program. Thank you so much for your generosity.
My name is Debbie, and I'm a client advocate here at the Pregnancy Health Center. However, on Wednesday mornings, I am privileged to meet with a group of ladies for a class called Coffee and Conversation. But as you all know, COVID has changed the way we social distance. And it became obvious to the Pregnancy Help Center that a larger room was going to be necessary if we were going to continue with class. Because of your generous donations, we very quickly were able to secure this larger room that we are meeting in. So on behalf of myself and the ladies in Coffee and Conversation, I would like to say thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sue, one of the volunteers here at the Pregnancy Health Center, Baby Boutique. I want to thank you for all the donations that you've given this past year. Because of your donations, the clients, through a point system, which they obtain by either going to a parenting class, Bible study, attending church, or many other ways, they can come here to the store and get baby equipment, clothes, shoes, books, toys, and many other items. Another thing we also do here at the store is give them baby gifts, a layette, when they have their new child. This also contains clothes and many other things that they can use as they first start out. So thank you very much for all you've done in this past year.
My name is Ron Evans. I'm the Men's Program Director.
During this unusual year, God has led the men's ministry in a direction we may not have gone if not for the situation that confronted us. With a great deal of guidance and input from Mackenzie Sanchez, our social media director, the men's program, called Dad Ready, now has its own Facebook page and Instagram account. God, who is sovereign over all, is also Lord of technology. He has used this year to take us down new roads that will enable us in 2021 to not only keep in touch with our clients and continue speaking truth into their lives, but also to reach men who may not come through the doors of the Pregnancy Health Center. So thank you. Thank you for sharing your word with the Pregnancy Health Center.
Please consider sharing this video with your friends, families, and church communities. You can do that by subscribing to our brand new YouTube channel, simply by searching for Pregnancy Help Center of Youngstown. You can also find this video and follow us on our donor page on Facebook titled Friends of Pregnancy Help Center. This video will be available on all those pages for sharing. And as always, feel free to follow our client pages, which can be found on Twitter at MyPregnancyHelp, Instagram at handle PregnancyHelpCenterOH, and of course, Facebook, simply at Pregnancy Help Center. Your continued support of the center makes the invaluable difference between one generation and the next. On our mission, may we always remember Psalm 22:10. From birth, I was cast on you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
What a wonderful ministry that they provide, and just so thankful that the Lord has connected us with them so that we can be a part of that as well. And I do hope that everyone, before you leave, as you make your exit today, there's a box at the back. Be sure to pick up your baby bottle and you can get started on that journey of supporting Pregnancy Help Center. Well, friends, at this time, we have the privilege to go to our Lord in prayer, where we can lay those burdens that have been weighing us down. We can lay those at the foot of the cross. And also, we have this just magnificent time where we can encourage one another by sharing our stories of how the Lord has blessed us through this past week. And at this time, if you have one of the prayer cards or praise cards, if you have any of those filled out, we'd be more than glad to have those collected. Just lift those up, and my good friend Mikey, he'll be more than glad to pick those up. If you do not have one filled out, we can still do this the good old-fashioned way. Just let me know what you have to say, and we'll be sure to share that. Some prayer requests that I already do have. I have a prayer request for April and Zachary. That is Wendy and Jerry's daughter and grandson. Be praying for them this morning as they're dealing with some different things. I know Zachary was having some allergy issues, so continue to lift them up in prayer. And man by the name of John, what's the last name?
Williams, Mark Mickey.
Oh, okay. Mark Mickey's son, John, he's going to be having an MRI on his back. So continue to keep him in prayer. And as always, I spoke with Sister Deborah yesterday. She sounded very good, very, very up in her voice. And she said she wouldn't be back this week, but she's going to try for next week, but she's on the mend from her tumble. And I told her, I said, man, she got to retire from this life of being a stunt woman, I'm telling you. Yeah, that's a rough career to be in. But she's definitely been through a lot with this last fall and also with the seizure. But continue to lift up Sister Deborah in prayer. And there is a baby named Emel, and he's in Ronnie's care. Just continue to pray for him. Is he the one with the separation anxiety?
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Right.
I continue to lift up this little young one, Emil, with the separation anxiety. Lisa's uncle, Francis, her brother, a gentleman by the name of Wayne Booksing, was on the prayer chain this week. He is in ICU with some serious health needs, praying for the Lord's touch upon him. We continue to lift up Paula Osich as she recovers from her broken wrist, as well as Lucille. She was in the hospital this week, had to make an adjustment, had to postpone her kolache bake, but spoke with Lucille yesterday, I believe, and she was feeling much better, and she'll be doing some traveling over the next 2 weeks, so not only pray for her health, but also traveling mercies for her as well, as she'll be visiting family in Newark, Ohio, as well as she'll be traveling, I believe, to North Carolina. Hilda has surgery coming up here at the end of the month on the 29th, and we'll just continue to pray for the Lord's touch upon her, that to bring healing to you as well as relief from any pain she's experienced, and so glad to see Hilda this morning. An update on Jim Galt, who's a friend of Lisa and I, and also Georgie Stofko's cousin. Jim was in the hospital at St. E's Youngstown and has been transferred to a rehab facility to do some physical therapy and things of that nature to get him back on track so that he can go home. So it was good to see Jim, and unfortunately in the hospital, but as I was talking to him, his eyes perked up and we had a good conversation. So continue to keep Jim and also his wife Sandy in prayer as well. And also I spoke with Carol Stofko. Continue to be praying for George as well, as he's going on with some health needs. Thank you, Mikey.
You're welcome.
Okay. We also have continue to be praying for our nation, our government, its leaders at all levels of government, that no matter what side of the aisle they sit on, that first and foremost, that they are seeking God in all of their decisions. And it doesn't matter who sits in that chair in the White House or at a Capitol building or whatever, it doesn't matter who sits there, God is still on his throne and God is still in control. So we continue to pray for our country. Yes, Lisa. Absolutely.
First, I surgery went well. Second is this Wednesday. Granddaughter Abby's foot is still bothering her. Tendons taking longer to heal. And Jessica's pregnancy is going well. Praise God.
Praise God. That was a mouthful there, wasn't it?
Yes.
But I'll tell you one thing. As frustrating as times, as modern day electronics and computers and things can be, we are so blessed to have our live stream ministry, to be able to connect with Murphy's down there in Florida and so many other people, not only in our community that aren't able to get out for whatever reason, but to connect with people that live so far away but still call Simon Road Church of God their church. And we are so blessed to have that. And as they said in the video, you know, God is the God of technology as well. And I just pray that at times he would make that technology a little more easier to manage or give me a better understanding of how to work it. But that's okay. That's on me. That's not on him. But a praise that I would like to share is, as you may have seen today, I am not using my cane. As much as I needed that cane through the process, and I may still need it here in the future, and I still have it in my office, but had the MRI on my knee, the opposite side of my surgery, and everything structurally, everything is really good. But made an adjustment in medication. That suggestion came from Dr. Cunningham and made the executive decision to quit taking this and start doing something else. And lo and behold, guess what? Knee feels a whole lot better. And I believe not only it was a change of medication, that was a touch from the Lord on my knee. And I praise Him every single day for that. And I won't be running in any marathons or any sprints anytime soon. But just so thankful to be walking around a little more freely than I was. And so thankful for the healing that the Lord has brought. Let me see, do we have any others that we'd like to share this morning? So thankful for see Cindy here today, and thankful for the healing that He has brought to your life and continues to bring. And we continue to lift you up in prayer as well. Yes, Lisa. Okay. Yes, if you didn't hear that, Lisa's job situation has become very complicated lately. So if you can lift her up in prayer in that whole situation, whatever God's will may be, let it be that. But she has remained faithful to her job and continues to do her job with excellence. Yes, Wendy.
Our son-in-law, Gene, his job has become very complicated also.
Oh, okay. Anyone else? Anyone have any unspoken requests that we'd like to signify by the uplifted hand? Lord knows our hearts, He knows our needs. So if you would join with me as we use this time and go to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You so much that we have You to turn to in times of trouble. Lord, we thank You that we have You to turn to when the storms of life hit. Lord, we thank You so much that we have You to hold on to when the road underneath us becomes unsteady. Lord, we thank You that we have You there to carry us through when we don't have the strength ourselves to move forward. Lord, we thank You for how You bring healing, for how You bring comfort in times of pain. Lord, how You provide doctors and nurses and care people with all the knowledge and wisdom to be able to treat the human body. Our body is such a complex thing and only could be created by You, Lord. Lord, we thank You for the wisdom that You impart on these medical people. Lord, we thank You for how You continue to work in the lives of Your children in so many different ways, from health needs to jobs to family issues to sinus and different infections, Lord. Lord, we thank You for how You continue to watch over Your children. And Lord, we thank You for the many blessings that You impart on us each and every day, Lord. In so many different ways, each and every one of us. Even if we have to look a little more closely, Lord, we can see You involved in our lives. Sometimes it might be difficult. Sometimes the circumstance that we're in might be a little overwhelming. But if we just take a step back, close our eyes and take a deep breath, we can see Your hand at work. So, Lord, we thank You so much that we have You in our lives. We thank You so much that You sent Your Son to Calvary's cross to pay the price for our sins, Lord. And Lord, we just pray today that our tithes and our offerings that we give, Lord, that whatever is given today, that You know the heart of each and every giver, and then what is given, Lord, you can take that and You can just multiply that. Just as You multiplied those fishes and loaves, Lord, You can provide this to further Your kingdom and proclaim Your name into all the corners of the earth until all have heard. So, Lord, in this time, in this place, it is my prayer that you move me out of the way and let your word speak to the hearts of those with ears to hear. Lord, only your words have the power to transform lives. The best motivational speaker in the world might just get us all pumped up and get us encouraged a little bit, but that wears off. Your word transforms lives. And Lord, only the creator of our hearts can do that. So Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, for each and every hand that went up, for each unspoken prayer today, Lord, not a word needs to be mentioned. You know the needs of our hearts, Lord. And you know how to answer those needs. So Lord, today we just humbly say thank you and we love you for how you bless us in each and every day in just so many different ways. And we will give you all the glory, honor, and praise as each prayer request will be answered. We have living, breathing, walking, talking testimonies to how you have touched people's lives today, how you have brought healing. Lord, we thank you for that. For it is in the matchless and powerful name of Jesus today we preach and we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, friends, good morning and welcome to the house of the Lord. So good to be with everyone this morning. And if you look to your left and to your right on the walls, you will see that we are very close to having nice, cool, comfortable air conditioning here in our sanctuary. Second phase is done. Third phase will be when they come in and they connect a few wires. We hit the button and oh, it'll be beautiful. Then we can break out the sweaters because everyone will be too cold. But that's okay. That's okay. That's all right. I have found the older I get, the greater appreciation I have for air conditioning.
Amen.
So, and I know we have days ahead that are going to be a lot hotter than this. But friends, thank you so much for joining us here today. And today's message, I just really felt the Spirit just pulling me, saying, boy, preach this today. You better preach this. So, as pastors always say, and they always give this advice, be obedient to the call of the Spirit on your heart. And I would be remiss if I don't do that myself. So each and every message I preach, the Spirit pushes me in that direction or pulls me in that direction or just lays it right there. So same with today's message. But I'd like to begin today's message just a little bit differently than what I'm used to. Well, first, let me get this stool out of my hand. I got to stand today. Too much sitting down on the job. But if you have your Bibles with you, I would like everyone to turn to what is probably without a doubt the most familiar and beloved single verse in the entire Bible. Please join with me as we look to the words found in John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 16. Friends, we're walking on familiar ground here with this verse. Martin Luther referred to John 3:16 as the gospel in miniature. No matter what denomination or church group you may have grown up in, if you went to Sunday school or went to church as a young child, you probably were taught to memorize this verse. So if you would, please read this aloud with me. And you can even say it by memory if you like. But it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I even put the King James Version up there for you today. So, what exactly is the setting for this verse? Well, if we remember, it was spoken to Nicodemus, who was a good and religious man. And although he was good and religious in man's eyes, he was nevertheless lost and on his way to hell. So let's take a look at verses 1-3 for context, to gain some context on this. And it reads as this. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Amen. Now, although Nicodemus was religious, he needed to be saved. He needed to be born again. The first birth is a physical birth. The second birth that Jesus is speaking of is to be born again spiritually in God's family. As a Pharisee, Nicodemus, well, he gave to the poor. He knew the Old Testament scriptures forwards and backwards, and he could probably recite the words of scripture in his sleep. But Jesus looked him straight in the eye and said, in essence, that all of his good works and all of his religious deeds and all of his good intentions and all of his heartfelt sincerity would not do one thing to get him into God's kingdom. Jesus told him back then the exact same thing that he tells us today. You must be born again. And so, my friends, today, that's the setting of this marvelous, precious verse that appears later on in a chapter, John 3:16. Jesus told Nicodemus what he did in John 3:16 so that Nicodemus could know how to be born into God's family and thus have forgiveness of all his sins. But let me ask you this question this morning. What if John 3:16 were not true? Friends, that's what I'd like for us to consider this morning. What if this precious jewel in the treasure chest of God's Word were not true? For instance, what if God had not loved the world? Well, the verse begins, "For God so loved the world," right? Without God's love, there would be no hope in this world. Our world would be a dark planet, hurling through space with absolutely no hope. There would be nothing to live for, with no purpose for our existence. We'd be living in a world where prayers were useless cries into the skies. Every death would be the end of all personal hope, and every grave a place of despair. In my years of ministry as a youth pastor formerly and now senior pastor, years back I've had the unfortunate experience of standing with a family as they mourned the loss of their loved one. A loved one who did not have a relationship with the Lord. I've heard family members scream through sobs of sorrow and heard their hearts break as they said goodbye to their loved one. You could literally hear the hopelessness of people without Christ. The harsh truth of the matter is that those who don't know Christ as Savior have no hope at all beyond the grave. So just think for a moment, if God had not loved the world and sent the living Savior. Think of a whole world in hopelessness and despair with no hope beyond this life. But praise God, I have some good news to share with you this morning. God does love the world. Everything around us speaks of God's love to humanity. Every sunrise and sunset that you see, every blade of grass out there, every fountain of water, every birth, every face of a child, they all speak of and are evidence of God's love. The greatest demonstration of God's love is on the cross. And that makes me think, well, what if God had not given his son? Well, the verse goes on to say that he gave his only begotten son, right? What if instead of God giving us his son, he gave us what we deserve? What if instead of sending his son to die for our sins and giving us the opportunity to have life worth living on this earth and eternal life to look forward to, what if he just sent us to hell? That's a pretty awful thing to consider, isn't it? You see, friends, if God loved the world but had not given his son, we would never be able to know and experience that love. God's love would be futile without the cross of Christ. You see, real love always demands giving something. And God showed his love for us by giving his most treasured possession. Paul shares these words in Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Praise God, right?
Yeah.
God did send his son to die on the cross for our sin. God has given his son, and apart from this, there is no salvation. Without sending his son, there would be no eternal life, and there would be no hope in this world. Life would simply be a meaningless existence. I want my life to be more than that. How about you? And friends, those people out there who believe that the chief end of life is pleasure would be right. That we should eat, drink, and be merry because after the grave there's nothing. That's what they believe. All that would be true had our Heavenly Father not sent his son to die for our sins. But praise God that he did. Amen? Let's look at the third part of the equation. What if God's offer of salvation was not for the whosoever's? If you look back in the verse at what Jesus told Nicodemus in John 3:16, it says that whosoever believeth in him. What a magnificent word, whosoever. What a comforting word. It's a word that's general, but yet particular. It embraces all of humanity, and yet it touches each and every one of us. It means the gospel is for everyone, which means that it's for you and it's for me. Yeah. Now do you see it? Whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Who can be saved? Whosoever. But there might be someone out there that's saying, well, wait a minute, Pastor. Wait a minute. Time out. That's all well and good, but you don't know my sin. You don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've been through, what I've done, yada, yada, so on and so forth. You say that. No. I don't know what your sin is. I don't know what you've been through. But God does. And he knew it 2,000 years ago when he gave this wonderful promise. In fact, listen to Paul's words again that I just read a few moments ago in Romans 5:8. But God demonstrates his love, his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God doesn't save us after we get rid of our sin. He meets us right where we are and saves us in our sin, just as we are. Isn't there an old song in our hymnal, Just As I Am? Those words are there for a reason. We sing about that for a reason. God meets us just as we are. But he loves us far too much to leave us as is. God doesn't save us once we clean up our lives to be good enough for him. He doesn't save us after we've made ourselves holy or religious. Friends, it's just the opposite. He saves us in our sin, just as we are. And he saves us from our sin and makes us who we ought to be.
Amen.
I don't know about you. You can look wherever you feel like. I don't think you can get a better deal than that. How precious to know that salvation is for all of us whosoever's. Whosoever you are, whether you're joining us here in person or if you're joining us online, if you're struggling, if you're tired, if you're hurting, if you're frustrated, if you're confused or overwhelmed, if you're carrying the burden of sin, if you're without Jesus as your Savior today, friends, I have some good news that you need to hear. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yeah.
Whosoever you are, if you're without Jesus as your Savior, there's no better day to come to Jesus than today. Let's look at the fourth part of the equation here. What if God's offer were not based on faith alone? And as we look at that verse, it says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So I'd like for you to picture in your mind and your heart three very common scenarios that are out there today. Picture with me all those trying to get to God through good works today. People who are sincere, hardworking, trying their very best, while the words of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through 9 says this, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Picture people everywhere who are trying to earn salvation by obeying God's laws. People who are in all-out effort to please God and make themselves just a little more worthy. These are people hoping to get to God by their goodness and righteous living, in spite of what God said through the words of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 64, verse 6. Isaiah said this, "All of us have become like the one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We are all shriveled up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away." Picture people living in a vain effort to get to heaven through religion, trusting in a certain church or denomination or faith group, trusting in certain religious rites like baptism or confession or communion. All that in spite of what Titus said in chapter 3, verse 5, which says, he saved us not because of the righteous things we have done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Spirit. Now picture this final scenario, and this one might surprise you. Hear these words found in Luke chapter 23, verse 42. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. A dying thief on one of three crosses of Calvary. On the cross in the middle is Jesus Christ, the sinless Lamb of God, dying for the sins of everyone, including the two thieves that were there with Jesus, one on each side of him. One of them mocked Jesus, but the other said to Jesus in faith, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Okay. Time out. Wait a minute. What exactly is going on with this? This man had lived his whole life in sin, right? And there was Jesus on the cross unjustly, having never once in his entire life committed a single sin, much less a felony worthy of death. But there's this thief. There's this outcast of society, a common thief, and apparently one who was incorrigible because the cross was not punishment imposed for common thievery. As was the rule of the time, only thieves who were repeat offenders and who were deemed incorrigible or irredeemable were punished by crucifixion. This was a thief, a sinner, a man of dishonesty. He was a fraud. It's quite doubtful that he ever lived a good life, or that he consistently tried to obey the commandments of God, or that he even did any good deeds for the poor. This man, he had probably never taken communion or been baptized. I doubt that he ever tithed or had done any righteous acts. How could such a man approach the most holy Son of God and ask him to remember him when he got to heaven? However, listen to what Jesus said to him. Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Friends, the dying thief on the cross was given the promise of eternal life with Jesus on the basis of only one thing, and that's faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus, the one who paid for his sin, paid his penalty right there on that cross, right there beside him in his place. So friends, as our praise team comes to lead us in a song, I propose this question to you. Have you put your faith wholly in the Lord Jesus? Don't try to clean up your sin first. You can never be good enough to be good enough. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. You can't inherit it from your parents. Friends, just like that thief on the cross, just trust in Jesus to save you from your sin. Friends, aren't you glad that John 3:16 is true?
Amen.
God does love the world, and that means that God loves you. That means that if you were the only person on this earth, God would have still sent his Son to die just for you.
Amen.
God gave his son to die for our sins. The blood that he shed on the cross is the only thing that can save us from our sins. Jesus was our substitute who paid the penalty for the sin that we deserved to die for. And God's salvation is for whosoever. That means anybody. That means the old and the young, the educated or not so educated, the lower class to upper class, wicked sinners like the thief on the cross, like that was with Jesus, or sinners like Nicodemus, who was an outwardly religious and moral man. And God's offer of salvation is by grace, through faith alone. Not your church, not your religion, not your works, or how much you put into an offering envelope, or whether you've been baptized or not. Friends, I believe that there's a whosoever out there who really needs to hear this message today. Whether you're a person here in person or joining us online, if you'd like to receive this gift of salvation, please let me know before you leave here today so that I may pray with you and help you with some next steps along your journey. And friends, also, I'd like to encourage you, if you know anyone who's not here today or not joining us online, but if you know someone who needs to hear this message, you can share it with them through our Facebook or our YouTube channel later on. Friends, it's like this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sunday of each month, we come together to share in a special time of communion. And if you don't have your communion elements and you need one, just raise your hand and we'll make sure to get one to you here. So, everyone have one that's going to work? Dave, you need one? You need one? Yes. Dave. Dave, yes, please. Friends, Jesus has set the table himself, and he has said, come to the table. He's inviting us, but he's also doing more than that. He's commanding us. So friends, as we approach the Lord's table this morning, we need to make sure that we come with a hunger for what the Lord has for us. And we also need to come with the proper heart attitude. This morning, we're just going to take a few moments here to calm our hearts today. We're going to take this time to see the importance of the Lord's Supper. Jesus taught his disciples in the upper room to do this in remembrance of the sacrifice that he was about to do for all of mankind. The Apostle Paul, he also saw the importance of following the Lord's teaching. And he encourages us to take time out to make sure that our hearts are clean, so that the attitude of our heart is right, so that we may partake of this communion properly. So before we proceed, I'd like for us to consider Paul's words as recorded in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 27 through 32. But to paraphrase, Paul says this, that we should examine ourselves before we eat of the bread or drink of the cup. Paul tells us, for those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ, eat and drink judgment on themselves. Friends, I firmly believe that this is something that should be done between each one of us and the Lord. He knows our hearts, and he knows if we are worthy of partaking of this communion today. So I'd just like to pause at this time, take a few moments to examine our hearts before the Lord, and get rid of anything that may interfere with sharing in this time of communion. We may partake today only if we meet the Lord at his table, not only with clean hands, but with clean hearts. So let us now pause for a time of self-reflection, and after that time, we will then share in this communion together. Today, I just pray that as we look at our hearts, Lord, that your Spirit bring to the front of our minds anything that may be interfering in our relationship with you, Lord. Lord, anything that does not belong there, we just pray that you remove that, that you equip us, and you just take that away from us, Lord. For it is our greatest desire that nothing stand in the way of our relationship with you. It is our greatest desire to be as close to you as we can. So Lord, it is in your name we pray. It is in the name of Jesus we pray today. Amen. So as Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, he looked at them, and he knew that this was some of the final moments that he would have with his friends. And he took the time to teach them one valuable thing, to remember. Take time to remember this. And through simple bread, through the contents of the cup, we do this to remember the sacrifice of Christ that he made for the whosoever's. He took the bread from the table, and he gave thanks. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for this bread that is symbolic of your body broken for us. Your body that was beaten and bruised and battered for nothing that you did, Lord. You took that punishment that was meant for us. Lord, we thank you for your great sacrifice, Lord, that was done for the whosoever's. You made that sacrifice, and we still hadn't even made that choice to follow you yet. But you made that choice. You made that choice to go to that cross and endure everything that you did. Just desiring that not one of us be lost. So Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice, and we remember that today. For it is in the matchless name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And next he took the cup. And the cup that he had on his table did not have this little seal on it. But he took the cup from the table. And he looked not only into the eyes of his brothers, but he could also see their hearts. He could also see their intentions. He also knew that in a short time that they would scatter. But he also knew that there was something more there, that they would scatter, but yet they could still be found and still be brought back. But he took the cup from the table and he gave thanks. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this cup that represents the blood of your Son Jesus, that blood that was spilled on the cross, that blood, the only blood that can wash away my sins, Lord. The only blood that can wash us as white as snow. So Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for each and every drop of blood that was shed, each and every drop symbolic of each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice, because that sacrifice enabled us to say, "Yes, Lord, we will follow you." That sacrifice enabled us to spend our eternity with you in heaven. Lord, we thank you. For it is in the matchless name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And then he took the cup and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." May you drink. As I said, we do this to remember the price that was paid as a ransom for all of mankind. Did you hear that? For all mankind. Not just for a select few, not just for his favorites. He did that for all. For the whosoever's. He did that as the propitiation for our sins. Once and for all. The debt has been paid. No other sacrifice is needed. So friends, do we have another song? Please lead us.
Congregation, please stand as we are raising.
Thank you.
friends, our altars are here. If you feel that the Spirit is pulling at your heart, you can come forward and spend some time with the Lord. Or if you'd like to be anointed, you can also come.
Jesus, we pray. Amen.